Syria and the West Bank from the Palestinians? Why are they systematically able to demolish homes on a daily basis, able to build illegal settlements in the occupied territories, and why are they able to strangle Palestinian people through their checkpoints and their occupation? Why will you not find a single serving American politician critical of Israel? Not one. And why has America become so hated by much of the world today? The answers to these questions will not be answered satisfactorily unless we factor in the influence of Western Christian Zionism. Let me begin by just summarizing that the Arab-Israeli conflict is the longest-running UN dispute. It is the most frequently debated UN dispute. It is the most pervasive religious conflict in the world today, Jews, Christians, and Muslims. It is the most dangerous military conflict, chemical, biological, and nuclear weapons. It is the most controversial media story in the West, and it is being perpetuated by Christians, sadly. A definition. Sorry, the size of the movement, probably between 10 and 40% of Christians in the West support Zionism. These statistics are an underestimate as to the size and significance of the movement. A definition, Ron Wagner. Evangelical Christian Zionism is a political movement within Protestant fundamentalist Christianity that views the modern state of Israel as the fulfillment of Bible prophecy, thus deserving our unconditional support. Where did it begin? Well, it began in the Reformation in the 15th century with renewed interest in the Hebrew writings, the Old Testament, and the place of the Jewish people. This idea was picked up by the European powers, Holland, Britain, France, Germany, and other nations. And you see in the 17th and 18th centuries, a colonial expansion in the Far East, in Africa, in South America, coinciding with missionary enterprise. The Bible and the sword, hand in hand. And as we heard earlier, Louis Napoleon was the first world ruler to promise the Jews a homeland. He did so because he wanted Jewish support to control the Middle East, defeat the British, and undermine their trade routes to Africa and India. He promised the Jews a homeland within the French Empire. And his agenda was one that Britain and Germany both began to pursue when he was defeated. At this time, Christian leaders in Britain in the 1820s, 1830s began to speculate that God had a plan for the Jewish people separate from the Christian community. And around this time, Lord Shaftesbury became convinced that it was Britain's destiny to assist the Jewish people back to Palestine. And he began to lobby on behalf of the Jewish community within the British political arena and within European political circles. And he probably achieved more than any other British politician to secure a Jewish homeland. When Theodor Herzl made his famous slogan, "A land of no people for a people of no land," he was borrowing a phrase that Lord Shaftesbury wrote 50 years earlier. David Lloyd George, Prime Minister in 1915, said, "Acetone converted me to Zionism." Chaim Weizmann was a Jewish chemist at Manchester University. He was devising a synthetic form of TNT. He assisted the British war effort against Germany in the First World War, and Zionism was the payback. Arthur James Balfour probably did more than any other British politician to further the Zionist cause. He was a convinced Christian Zionist. And the Balfour Declaration, which promised the Jewish people a promise to protect the rights of the indigenous Arab population was actually written by the Zionist organization for the British government. The British government modified it and ensured that Britain was only promising the Jews the right to live within the British Empire. The fact is that Britain had another agenda. Publicly, we were promising the Jews our homeland, promising the Arabs their support. But in reality, we had agreed with the French that we would split the Middle East between us. Therefore, our government, the British government, was entirely duplicitous in its agenda. We intended to divide the Middle East between the French and the British. Consequently, the British mandate from 1947 sought to control Palestine for the British Empire. We restricted the rights of both Jews and Arabs. When Britain discovered that it could not rule the waves, could not control Palestine, the partition plan from the United Nations, 1947, was a feeble attempt to divide Palestine. The War of 48 saw Israel conquer much of the land that had been allocated for Palestine. And the subsequent borders, the ones that we see today, are the result of Christian Zionist support for the Zionist cause. If I had more time, I would like to explain to you how this theological movement became a political reality. All I want to emphasize today is that Christian support for Zionism has mushroomed in the last 20, 25 years, partly as a result of the influence of people like Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan. Strong relationship between the Christian right and the Israeli right, Menachem Begin, for example, 76-77, facilitated by Christian leaders such as Jerry Falwell. Ronald Reagan took over from Jimmy Carter. He was a convinced Christian Zionist, convinced that there would be a war in the Middle East that would lead to the return of Jesus. Since 1980, people like Jerry Falwell, Pat Robertson, Senator Bob Dole, Gary Barr, Dick Armin, and others have lobbied the U.S. establishment on behalf of the state of Israel. Since 9/11, we've seen a convergence of the political right and the Christian right working hand in hand with the Zionist agenda. Let me give you a flavor of the movement, and in particular, the writings of one individual. This shows how the political agenda of Christian Zionism is working out. Strong lobbying in Congress on behalf of Israel by Christian groups. Funding the return of Jewish people to Palestine. Sustaining the settlements, Christian churches adopting and funding the Jewish settlements. Lobbying for Jerusalem to be recognized as the capital of Israel. Showing solidarity with the Temple Mount movement and opposing the peace process. John Hagee is probably the most influential Christian Zionist leader today in America. He is a good friend of Senator John McCain, the Republican candidate. He is the leader of a church in Texas with 18,000 members. His organization, Christians United for Israel, is beamed into 99 million homes on a weekly basis through his television programs, his radio stations. This is what he said in 2006, at an inaugural meeting at which the Israeli ambassador and many US senators were present. He said the United States must join Israel in a preemptive military strike against Iran to fulfill God's plan for both Israel and the West. A biblically prophesied end-time confrontation with Iran will lead to the return of Christ. In 2007, he said at the APAC, the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee, the sleeping giant of Christian Zionism has awakened. There are 50 million Christians standing up and applauding the state of Israel. The Jerusalem Post said his speech did not lack clarity. He went on to say, it's 1938, Iran is Germany, and the man in the jail is the new Hitler. We must stop Iran's nuclear threat. Israel can stand boldly with Israel in early democracy in the Middle East. Think of the potential future together. 50 million evangelicals joining in common cause with 5 million Jewish people in America. On behalf of Israel, it is a match made in heaven. Its movement is a very powerful one in American political circles, but I want to assure you that it is a minority in America within the Christian community. It probably represents 20% of Christians in America. Worldwide, it represents less than 5%. The overwhelming majority of Christians in the world repudiate Christian Zionism, but it is wealthy and powerful with the media and political circles in America today. The heads of the churches in Jerusalem have repudiated Christian Zionism as a heresy. I helped to put together a declaration which was signed by the main heads of the churches in Jerusalem last year, the Roman Catholic Patriarch, the Syrian Orthodox Patriarch, the Episcopal Bishop, and the Evangelical Lutheran Bishop. All have repudiated Christian Zionism as a heresy. And if you would like to explore the subject further and engage with Christian leaders who are challenging Christian Zionism, I would recommend the website ChristianZionism.org. It is opposed to Christian Zionism. And my own website, Sizes.org. And on there you will find many useful resources, my articles, PowerPoint presentations, video, and audio presentations. Jesus has called his followers, "Blessed are the peacemakers, they shall be called the children of God." As Christians, Jews, and Muslims, let us embrace that sentiment and work for peace and justice in the Middle East. Thank you.